Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory to the Lamb. How's everybody?
Blessed
and highly favored. Man, you don't realize how blessed you are.
Amen.
You don't realize how blessed you are. Because we are extremely blessed.
Amen.
You know, as we were worshiping, I heard the Spirit say, another wave of exposure. In other words, peeling. I saw the wave. It's a wave that's, and he said, and more will come. It's a wave of peeling, peeling back so things are being seen. I want to share something before I, which I guess it figures in, you know, praise God. You know, we are, again, I want to emphasize the time and season that we are in. There's a change of hands that are in our in the United States of government.
Thank you, Jesus.
But there has been...
Thank you, Jesus.
There has been much destruction done to this country.
Amen.
Now, the word talked about John the Baptist as a voice coming out of the wilderness. And that's what the, one of the things the Spirit is sharing with. We have a, I think we even have a teaching, voice in the wilderness. And the voice in the wilderness, even though it may be a small voice, may be a strong voice. And it's the area of maintaining. And, you know, we want to not only maintain our position, we want to maintain the integrity of Christ. We want to maintain divine order, but we also want to maintain our vision. And there is a vision that God gives, and I'm going to talk more about that and what it actually means, maintaining your vision. But in this, there has been much destruction, and you got to understand, and I'm sharing this because it's time to really explode, because one of the words that was given to me for 2007 was exposure. It's, in other words, explosive. It's, there's explosion. In other words, everything's going to explode. 2017. It's a word of called exposure. And exposure. Would you like me to write it down for you, little girl? 2017. Exposure. E-X, never mind. Exposure. Pretty interesting, huh? It's going to be explosive exposure. But all kinds of other things are going to happen. It's exposure. And, you know, one of the things that has been happening for such a long time, when you begin to look back at, you know, how something was established. In other words, Lucifer exalted himself, was removed from God's presence, and he was sentenced to the second heaven, and of course, into the atmosphere here and so forth. And then he deceived Adam, and there was chaos. So a chaos established in heaven. When God removed Lucifer, that was chaotic. And then, and it says, and war broke out in heaven in the book of Revelations in 12. And Lucifer and a third of the angels was removed. And then, chaotic broke out in the garden when Adam and Eve fell to the perversion of Lucifer. And chaotic broke out. And then they were removed from there. And it's been still going on. In fact, and I'm probably not going to pronounce this correctly, but I'm going to throw it out there. It's called ordo chaos, something like that. And it is a Latin word, and it's associated with Mason, or what we call Illuminati, or the global government, or the elite, or so forth. And it's associated with the 33rd degree of Mason. And what it actually means is they create chaos to bring in their order. In other words, they create chaos, and then they come up with a solution which brings them order. It allows them to step in to taking control. And this has been going on from the fall of Lucifer. People have no idea what's going on. I want you to understand, and I'm exposing this because something occurred today that just really ticked me off. And I'm tired of it. And I don't care. When I found out that Obama, who is anti, and I want to say this because the voice of the body of Christ needs to speak for America. I want you to know, and I'm sharing this right now, Obama does not speak for America. Amen. The Democratic Party does not speak for America. The Republican Party does not speak for America. The people of America speak for America. Amen. And this is what this is about. Because they are not speaking what American people want to be spoken. And today, and you know what? It's like true colors come out. You know them by their fruits. Amen? And so one of the things that occurred, Obama approved for the first time ever in the last 35 or whatever, since we've been friends with Israel, he approved that what the UN agreed on, that Israel must give up land, that Israel could no longer pray in Jerusalem, that Israel, I'm telling you, what has just happened today is now written in law by the United Nations. What it's done is just give an open door for every country to destroy Israel. It's opened a door for every country to come against Israel. But again, Obama does not speak for this country. He is anti-Christ. He is evil and wicked, and so are the Clintons and all the rest of them, even the Bushes, all of them, they're all associated. Who do you think created Al-Qaeda? Bushes. They funded it and did everything. Everything is associated. Why? Because they create a chaos, then they create a solution, and they put in their order. Does everybody get it? And it's still going on. And it will continue to go on until the voice in the wilderness begins to speak out and expose. Does everybody understand? I'm going to get more in depth in all this later at another time, but not tonight. But I just want you to know, because this thing just really, it's like, whoa. So, you know, there are evil organizations. The number one most evil organization in the world today is not Al-Qaeda or Islam. It's the Democratic Party. It is the most evil, wicked organization in the world today. It has nothing to do with all of the people. The second wicked, evil organization is the Catholic Church. Now, people need to search this thing through to the root when you find out what's going on. I didn't say all the people in it were evil or wicked, but I'm telling you that the two most wicked, evil organizations in the world is the Democratic Party and the Catholic Church right now. They are the most wicked that there is, and it's going to get worse. Now, there are many innocent individuals that are caught up and associated in all these things, and of course, you got many evil organizations. You got Mormons, and look at, what does the devil want to do? Promote religions under his rule and control. All of these organizations that are associated with wickedness, denying the power of Christ. Anyone who denies the power of Christ Jesus, does everybody get it? Is associated with wickedness. And that's what Jesus said. It's blasphemy. And people don't even realize it. But in this, there is a place where you and I, again, there are sweet, innocent people that are deceived and stupid in these organizations. because they've been lied to. But it doesn't mean that they're wicked. But the organizations are very wicked. Very. And there are many of them. Many. There's only one organization, which is not even an organization. It's an organism. It's called the Kingdom of God because it's alive and it's living and it represents eternity. Has everybody got it? Would you grab your swords, please, and go to 1 Corinthians 13? You look at Google. You look at all of these censoring. You look at even the FBI and CIA and all of these law enforcement agencies that are actually controlled under Satan's kingdom. Think about all of the journalists, all right? I mean, there really isn't any more real journalism. Amen. They just take everything at face value. Anyone what says, nobody searches out anything. Because if they were to really search out everything, they would expose the wickedness in the organizations, but they don't. Oh, hallelujah. So it's time for the voice in the wilderness, which is every one of our voices, is to stand out, to speak out, to share. You know, there are people that just don't get it. They have no idea. Because they've been living in deception for so long that they have no idea. But things are going to get better and things are going to get worse. More will be deceived, but it'll be a part of one of the largest harvests. Because chaos, God will turn for his glory. What the enemy will try to do, God is going to interrupt. Exposure, explosiveness, all kinds of things are getting ready to happen. In 1 Corinthians 13, is everybody there? In verse 1, though I speak with tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I have become sounding brass or a clinging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. Now he's going to explain love. This is not worldly love. Does everybody get it? This is not lust, because worldly love is lust. Verse 4. Love suffers long and is what? Kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. It is not what? Puffed up. Does not behave rudely. Does not seek its own. Is not provoked. Thinks no evil. Well, you know what? That's powerful. What has just been expressed is the love of God. It's the love that you and I carry that's given from God. But that love cannot be established without relationship. It can't be. Other than that, the love of an individual will be associated with the lust of the world and not the love of God. Look at this. It does not rejoice in what? Iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Bear all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. This love never, never fails. Never. But whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be what? Done away with. It'll be done away with. Now he goes and explains. He said, when I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. And what childish things was he putting away? Lust. Worldly love. Why? Because he just explained what godly love was. Verse 12. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I am known. And now abide in faith, hope, love. These three, but the greatest of these is love. Now let me explain to you what love is not. Love is not arrogant. It is not prideful. It is not resentful. It is not unsubmissive or rebellious. And it is not unforgiving. Children think this way. Somebody got it? Children always think that they're adults. Children always think that they're what? Adults. Yes. Physical and spiritual, dear. Why? Children always think that they're adults with self-earning or self-earning rewards. I earned this. Resisting correction. It says God is love. So when the love of God is in me and you, all of these fruits will be manifested for really maintaining connection with the Lord. Amen? We'll be quick to forgive. We're just going to be submissive. We're going to reject pride and become humble. We won't become resentful. God is love. It says, if you love him, you will obey him. If you love him, you will obey him. If you love him, you will obey him. Love, the expression of love in godliness, is the expression of submission. It's an offering. Amen? It's a sacrificial offering. Why? Because you're offering yourself to God, to love, to forgive, to bless when you're persecuted, to depart from evil, to hate evil, to expose evil. Those are all attributes of the love of God. In 1 John chapter 4. This is all a part of tonight's maintaining your vision, and we'll explain what that is in a minute. 1 John chapter 4. In verse 7. First John chapter 4 and verse 7. Let's speak it. Beloved, is everybody there? Let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Everyone say, live through him. Not live through us, live through him. In this love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be a propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. I'm going to say it again. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. Again, if we love one another, God abides in us. But where there's not love for one another, God is not there. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son as Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God abides in him and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. Oh, that's so powerful. Was he a voice?
Yes.
Did he expose? Yes. Verse 18. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. So love is a choice. Amen? Look at God is love. And you know, we are coming to a place of perfection by due process of trials and tribulations. We are coming to a place of perfecting God's love. But it's a due process of trials and tribulations and testing. But these trials and tribulations and testings are to those willing to seek conviction. Because if you're not one who seeks conviction, then you're not one who's willing to examine himself. Amen. Does everybody get it? We are, though, this is this process of perfection, the place of perfection, perfecting God's love, is a due process of trials and tribulations and testing to those willing to seek conviction, counsel, chastening, and redirection. Now, fear is used to protect pride. It is a self mechanism by the carnal and fallen nature. Fear is used to protect pride, which protects self, the old man, or the fallen nature. Does everybody understand that? Pride. Pride is what removed Lucifer from God's presence. Pride is the number one killer of mankind. Pride, personal reverence into a deadly end. Pride. Why? Because pride rejects love. I'm going to say it again. Pride rejects love. I'm going to say it again. Pride does what? Reject love. Fear is used to protect pride. And it says that perfect love casts out fear. So when perfect love does not manifest the love of God, fear is taking control. And again, fear is a protector of pride. And pride is a protector of self, which is a fallen nature of the old man. Amen? Has everybody got it? Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 3, maintaining your vision. First Corinthians 3. So all of this influence and everything that's happening right now is trying to get us off course. All kinds of things that it's going on in the world. Again, if you don't hate evil, then you don't have the love of God. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 1. And he says, and I, brethren, could not speak to you as to spiritual people, but as carnal, old, but as to what?
Babies
in Christ. In other words, that's old man, children, babies. I fed you with milk and not with solid food, for until now you are not able to receive it. And even now you are still not able. For you are still carnal, you are still of the old nature, you are still fleshly. Where there are envy and strife and divisions among you, are you not carnal and behaving like what?
Mere men.
Wow. For when one says, I am of Paul, another, I am Apollos, and are you not carnal? Again, not the purpose he's expressing this and correcting them is because they are not able to digest solid food. Does everybody get it? They could not digest solid food. Why? Because pride cannot digest solid food. When pride is involved and solid food is given, it is turned to expand pride and promote pride. Because it can be not be fully digested. And because of that, it cannot be fully understood. Not able to digest solid food results in pride. Pride cannot digest solid food because of envy, strife, and divisions, acting like children, protecting self, and not growing in the love of God. Again, pride is a killer. It prevents a person from growing. It stunts their growth. That's where the word says, always learning, 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 and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Because in that knowledge of the truth, there's a practice of truth which sets a person free. In Hebrews chapter 2. Maintaining your vision. So one of the things that will steal your vision is pride. You cannot maintain the vision of that's given by God without the love of God. In Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 1. Let's speak it. Therefore, we must give the more earnest heed to the things we have heard, lest we what? Drift away. Lest we what? Drift away. For if the word spoken through angels proved steadfast and every transgression and disobedience received a just reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by those who heard him? God also bearing witness both with signs and wonders, with various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit, according to his own will. For he has not put the world to come of which we speak in subjection to angels. But one testified in a certain place, saying, what is man that you are mindful of him, or son of man that you care for him? For you have made him a little lower than the angels. You have crowned him with what? Glory and honor, and set him over the works of your hands. You have put all things in subjection under his feet. This is so powerful because he's talking about me and you. Amen? See, many drift away from their vision. I want to explain a couple things about vision. Vision is also associated with cause. What is the cause? Vision is associated with cause. People think, well, I had a vision and this is what I'm supposed to do. No, this is not what vision is about. There are visions that bring direction. Amen? There are visions that bring correction. But there is vision that is cause. What is your cause? Your cause. There are three levels of vision or cause. We've talked about these before. There's the calling of your cause or your vision. There's a purpose of your cause. And there's a destiny of your cause. So by maintaining your vision, you are maintaining the cause. And one of the things that many people do is they drift from the cause. What was the cause of your rescue? What is the cause of you living? What's your cause? That is called vision. It's also known as purpose. Is everybody okay? I'm going to say this again. There are three levels of vision, or what we call cause. Your calling, your purpose, and destiny. Each level increases and becomes more and more clear as the love of God increases. Does everybody get this? In this, what is the cause? Okay, when we talked about a purpose and destiny. So your vision is cause. What's one of the causes? To never go back to where you came from. That should be a cause. I never want to go back where I came from. And I want to remember your first cause is never go back where you came from. Second is remember where you came from. The third cause is remember your mistakes and don't repeat them. The fourth cause is remember others' mistakes and don't do them. The fifth cause is to monitor your thoughts and fruits. These are just simple causes, and you can ask the Holy Spirit to impart specific causes for you. The sixth cause is remember your new identity. See, you don't want to drift from these causes. You don't want them. This is maintaining your vision. And the seventh, which is constant. Are you ready? It's eternal. It's eternal. Why? You want to live from the future. This is your seventh cause. You're living from the future. Why? Because your cause is eternal. Everything that you do should be associated with something eternal. No matter what you're doing today, there should always be an eternal cause involved. Because you know that there's going to be an eternal judgment involved. So there should always be an eternal cause involved. Is everybody okay? Hebrew, or Habakkuk. Hallelujah. It's in here somewhere. Habakkuk chapter 2. So by maintaining your vision, you are maintaining your cause. Everybody got it? In this, these causes are really engraved in us. They're written in us. If we're paying attention. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 1. Habakkuk. Man, my kids must have harassed this dude in school. Hallelujah. Anyways, we won't go there. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 1. I will what? Stand my watch. I will set myself on the rampart and watch to see what he will say to me and what I will answer when I'm what? Corrected. What's he willing to accept? Correction. So he's looking for what? Conviction. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision, write the cause, and make it plain on the tablets that he may run who reads it. In other words, it's for us to remember. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, and at the end it will speak, and it will not lie. Though it tarries, wait for it, because it will surely come and will not tarry. Behold, the proud, his soul is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith. And faith is spiritual sight. So you see how this is all connected. Watch, see, looking for correction or conviction, the cause of vision. Again, faith is spiritual sight. Write it in your mind and your hearts so you won't forget it. Amen. Now, what is the cause in the all-around arena, it's cause for the kingdom, not for yourself. Amen. The vision isn't for you, it's for the kingdom. You know, one of the things that people need to do is stop telling God what your future is. Oh, God, this is what I want to be. No. You let God be God and you be his children. And allow him to unfold his will and your future as long as you maintain your vision, your cause. Everything will flow. Perfecting each level of call, purpose, and destiny with the love of God. Is everybody okay? Philippians chapter 2. Hallelujah. Maintaining your vision. How many of y'all know that there's training involved?
Amen.
Amen. How many of y'all know that there's death involved?
Amen.
That formula never stops, you know. Deny yourself, pick up the sword, pick up the cross, and follow. It never stops. It's constant also. It's all a promoter of the cause, the vision. In verse 1, Philippians chapter 2, verse 1, therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, of course, none of the things are going to manifest unless there's fellowship with the Spirit. Fulfill my joy by being what? Like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Well, snap. Let each of you look out not only for his own interest, but also for the interests of others. Not being a busybody. Hello. And let this mind be in you also. Go to verse 12. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but how much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. Do all things without what?
Complaining
and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless children of God, without fault and in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Nice. That we may be lights in this world. Be like-minded. Amen. Getting rid of the selfish ambitions and conceit and pride and arrogance. In other words, without fellowship with the Spirit, your cause isn't maintained, and neither is the love of God. So we're to be holding fast to the word of life and maintain your vision in the kingdom. Remember, this vision and cause is for a kingdom. It's kingdom business, not our business. It's kingdom business. Maintain your vision in the kingdom, not in the world. Listen, you and I were born in the world, but we are taken out of the world and born into the kingdom of God. His love and his purpose. We're to leave the kingdom of the world and live in the kingdom of God. Does everybody get it? In Ephesians chapter 4. In verse 1. Let's speak it, please. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. With all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Walk worthy of your calling. In other words, walk worthy of your cause, your vision. Amen. Purpose. 2 Timothy 1. Second Timothy chapter 1 and verse 8. Walk worthy. Is everybody there? It says, remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel, for which I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even to the point of chains. But the word of God is what? Not chained. Oh, I'm in verse 2. I'm sorry. Chapter 2. Hallelujah. What sounded good, though? But the word always sounds good. 2 Timothy 1:8. Let's try it again. Therefore, do not be what? Ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share with me in the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God, who has saved us and called us with a what? A holy calling. Not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. Before what? Before time began. But it has now been revealed by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, to which I was appointed a preacher and an apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles. For this reason I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep what I have committed to him until that day. Hold fast the pattern of sound words which you have heard from me in faith and love which are in Christ Jesus. That good thing which was committed to you, keep by the Holy Spirit who dwells in you. So we have walk worthy of your calling, and your calling is what? Holy. So this vision is holy. Does everybody get it? Your cause is holy. It's nothing to be, it's not general. It's not natural. It's supernatural. God has placed this cause in you. It is in this purpose. Your call, your purpose, and your destiny has a cause. It's an eternal cause. It's everlasting. And it's established by God's love. In Romans 12. In verse 3. Oh, hallelujah. For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but think soberly, as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, but all the members do not have the same function, but everyone has the same cause. Has everybody got it? Now, we might have a different function, an operation, but we all have the same cause. So we being many are one body in Christ and individually members of one another. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that was given to each of us, let us use them. If prophecy, let us prophesy in proportion to our faith. Or ministry, let us use it in our ministering. He who teaches in teaching, he who exhorts in exhortation, he who gives in with liberty, he who leads with diligence, he who shows mercy with cheerfulness. Let love be without what? Hypocrisy. Not lust, love. Abhor what is what? Evil. Cling to what is good. Be kindly, affectionate to one another with brotherly love. In honor, giving preference to one another. not lagging in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing steadfastly in prayer, distributing to the needs of the saints, giving to hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. Be of the same mind toward one another. Do not set your mind on high things, but associate with the humble. Do not be wise in your own opinion. Repay no evil for evil. Have regard for good things in the sight of all men. If it is possible, as much as depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Therefore, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him drink. For in so doing, you will heap coals of fire on his head. That's why I go out and feed everyone. No. So in this, we've got to look at this, where somebody's an idiot out there or a moron, hello, who knows the truth and rejects it, bless them. Just bless them. Amen? Now, don't give, what you're not supposed to give. Just bless them. I said that to somebody who was talking to me on the phone. He was getting all stupid and whatever. And I said, look, man, I just forgive you and I bless you. He didn't want it. I don't want your forgiveness and blessing. Okay. It's already released. Bye. Praise God. In verse 21, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with what? Good. Hallelujah. Again, there are many members with different functions, but same cause. Amen? So, and what's the purpose? To expand the kingdom with the love of God, right? And truth. So, maintaining your vision in faith. Now, listen. In functionings and in maintaining your vision and faith, we use worldly substance with kingdom integrity. We use what? Worldly substance with kingdom integrity. Listen, if your function has become a doctor or a nurse or whatever it is, that's the operation. Amen? Why? God's going to use that to infiltrate the world, isn't he? Whatever it may be. You may not be called to be a pastor or whatever, but everybody's called to evangelize. And you don't have to stand behind a pulpit. God is looking for marketplace ministry. He wants us to infiltrate. Amen? So whatever it is that your function is, again, a business person, whatever it may be, you do it with integrity and kingdom values because you're carrying that cause. You're maintaining your vision. Amen? Now, there are goals in this, and I want to share three goals. The first goal of your cause is to make it home. Hello. Make it home, eternal home, man. That's a goal. So whatever you're going to do, whatever your decisions are, in that cause, it should be always a part of that goal cause, which says, man, is this going to affect my eternal life or not? That should be the first goal of your cause. Make it home. The second goal is what we call a short term is, look at, make sure you examine yourself. Be honest. Amen. Honest and examine yourself. Amen? And of course, your third goal is, what you might consider your medium. Actually, your first goal... Your first goal of your cause is to make it home is actually your long-term goal. It's constant. It never stops. Your second goal is your short-term goal. In other words, it's every day. Examine yourself and be honest. And then your third goal, which is you might call your medium, is to keep learning, trust, and seek God's will. To learn, to trust, and to seek God's will. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Is everybody okay? And see, that's why he says write it down. Why? Because you won't forget. Second Corinthians 5 and verse 9. Therefore, we make it our what? Aim. We make it our what? Aim, whether present or absent, to be well-pleasing to him. Hello. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. Hello, that ought to be. Listen, I better maintain my long-term goal. Home. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what has been done, whether good or bad. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are all well known to God, and in also trust is well known in your consciences. For we do not commend ourselves again to you, but give you opportunity to boast on our behalf, that you may have an answer for those who boast in appearance and not in what? Not in heart. Boast in appearance and not in heart. So we want to make sure that we are well-pleasing to God. Amen. 2 Corinthians 13. In verse 5. Are you ready? What's the first word? Examine yourselves as to whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Do you not know that yourselves, that Jesus Christ is in you? Unless indeed you are what? Disqualified. How many of y'all know what the enemy wants to disqualify you? But I trust that you will know that we are not disqualified. Now I pray to God that you do no evil. Not that we should appear approved, but that you should do what is honorable, though we may seem disqualified. For we can do nothing against the what? Truth. But for the truth. For we are glad when we are weak and you are strong. And this we also pray, that you may be made what? Complete. Therefore I write these things, being absent, lest being present I should use sharpness according to the authority which the Lord has given me, for edification and not for destruction. Finally, brethren, farewell. Become complete. Be of good comfort. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the love of God and peace be with you. And I'm going to close at 1 Peter chapter 4. And if you can't examine yourself, ask someone to do it for you. And don't ask someone that's living out of order to examine you. Don't call up someone that you know is backslidden and doing some stupid stuff or in rebellion to the house of God. Amen. Yeah, man, what do you think? Oh, man, you're fine. Yeah, right. You'd be both going to hell. Hallelujah. 1 Peter chapter 4. In verse 1, please. Therefore, since Christ suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the what? Same mind. For he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from what? Sin. That he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh for the lust of money, men, which is what? Money, men, and whatever else. Which is love. The lust of the world is love. But for the will of God, which is the love of God. For we have spent enough of our past lifetime in stupidity and doing the will of the Gentiles. When we walked in lewdness, lust, drunkenness, revelries, drinking parties, and abominable idolatries. And regarding these, they think it strange that you do not run with them in the same flood of dissipation. Speaking what? Evil of you. Why? Because you're resisting evil now. Believe me, when you resist evil, evil gets upset. But here it is. Are you ready? They will give an account to the Lord who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this reason, the gospel is preached also to those who are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but live according to God in the spirit. But the end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be what? Serious and watchful in your prayers. And above all things, have fervent love for one another, for love will cover a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without what? Grumbling. As each one has received the gift, minister it to one another as a good steward of the manifold grace of God. And if anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. If anyone ministers, let him do it with the ability which Christ supplies, that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom belong the glory and the dominion forever and ever. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Maintaining your vision is maintaining your cause. Amen?
Amen.
Father, we give you all glory and honor and praise. We thank you for your word and thank you for your warning. I pray today, Lord, that this be imparted into our spirit and brought to remembrance every day, maintaining that long-term goal and maintaining not only the long-term but all the goals and maintaining our vision. Cause, calling, purpose, and destiny, that we may be well-pleasing to you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And everybody said amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Be blessed and stay dressed with the glory.